This is Coding Math, episode 40, Fractal Trees. Well, after four episodes of early integration, I figured I earned myself another fractal episode. So today we'll look at fractal trees. First, a quote from Benoit Mandelbrot. Clouds are not spheres, mountains are not cones, coastlines are not circles, and bark is not smooth. Nor does lightning travel in a straight line. Mandelbrot was the person who coined the term fractal, and has come to be known as the father of fractals. That quote is from his book, The Fractal Geometry of Nature. The point is that nature is riddled with examples of fractals, forms that have self-similarity on different scales. A tree is a perfect example. It has a trunk which splits into branches. Those branches become like mini trunks, splitting off into their own branches, which split again. Of course, this doesn't continue infinitely by any means, but enough to make the fractal nature blindingly obvious. The fractal tree we'll start out with will be pretty simple. A trunk that splits halfway up into two branches. One branch angles off to the right, the other off to the left. When we iterate it, each of those branches split into two sub-branches. And the four of those split again. We can structure this much the same way we did the Sierpinski triangle and Koch curve. There'll be an iterated function that gets a couple of points and a limit. The points, p0 and p1, will be the bottom and the top of the tree. The function will calculate three new points. pa will be the branching point, pb will be the top of one branch, and pc will be the top of the other. One difference will be that we will always draw the trunk. Then, if the limit is greater than 0, we'll call the tree function, recursively passing in pa and pb. And again with PA and PC. If limit reaches 0, we'll just draw the lines from PA to PB and PC. Pretty straightforward. Let's code. I'll start by creating P0, which will be mid-screen near the bottom, and P1, which will be mid-screen near the top. A branch angle variable will tell us what angle those branches will veer off at. I'll set this to 45 degrees, or math pi divided by 4 radians. I want to make that branching point halfway from the bottom to the top of the tree, so I'll set a trunk ratio variable to 0.5. Now we'll create the recursive tree function. This will get two points and a limit variable. We're always going to need these three new points, so let's create them. First, I'll find the distance from p0 to p1 on both axes, dx and dy, and then the total distance with math square root. We'll also need the angle between those, so I'll grab that using Math 8tan 2. Now we can get PA easily. Its x will be POX plus DX times trunk ratio. And its DY will be POY plus DY times trunk ratio. PB and PC will run out from this point A at different angles. I'm going to get the branch length, which will be the total distance times 1 minus trunk ratio. Now, of course, 1 minus trunk ratio is going to be 0.5, the same as trunk ratio itself. But later, we'll be able to easily change trunk ratio to, say, 0.6, and branch length will be the distance times 0.4. Now, PB will be a new point. Its x will be PAX plus the cosine of the angle we just calculated plus branch angle times branch length. And its y will be PAY plus math sine angle plus branch angle times branch length. All basic trig there is covered in earlier videos. PC will then follow the same pattern, but will subtract branch angle this time. So PB will vary from the main tree angle off to the right, and PC will vary off to the left. Now remember that I said we always want to draw the trunk, so let's get that out of the way. Begin a path, move to P0, line to PA, and stroke. Now we check the limit to see what to do next. If limit is greater than 0, we need to iterate more. So we'll call tree again, passing in PA and PB, and limit minus 1. And again with PA, PC, and limit minus 1. Otherwise, we've reached the limit and can instead draw the lines that make up the branches. We'll begin a path and just move to PC, line to PA, and then PB, and stroke. And that's a basic tree. Now we can call the function with a limit of 0, and we have a tree with two branches. And here's a limit of 1, 2, 3, 4, and then we'll jump up to 8 iterations, which is about the limit of where you'll see a real difference. Because we set certain values as variables, it's now very easy to start changing those up. We can even randomize them. I'm going to paste in the random range function we created back in Coding Math Mini number 6. Then instead of hard coding branch angle to a set value, I'm going to have it be a random range between 0 and 90 degrees, or 0 in math pi divided by 2 radians. Now when we run this, we get all kinds of different trees. I'll jump back in and do the same thing for a trunk ratio, giving that a range from 0.25 to 0.75. Again, more variety. Some of these trees look ridiculous, some almost realistic. One thing that is keeping them from looking too true to life is that they're all totally symmetrical. Real trees have some variations. So rather than using one angle to go one way, and the same angle to go the other way, let's have two separate random angles. I'll change branch angle to branch angle A, and give it a range from minus math pi divided by 2 to plus math pi divided by 2. This will allow it to bend up to 90 degrees in either direction. Then I'll duplicate that for branch angle B. I'll use angle plus branch angle A to create one branch, and angle plus branch angle B for the other one. Now we have some trees that look even more realistic, and some that don't look very realistic, but still have some kind of beautiful patterns going on. If we want to push this further into reality, we should notice that we have perfect self-similarity here. Each branch is a perfect copy of the whole, in that it uses the same angles and ratios. Real trees, again, would have more variance. So at the end of each iteration, I'll add a random amount to each branch angle and to trunk ratio. This will make it so that no two branches are exactly alike. Now we get some real variety here. Sometimes it lapses into total chaos, others look like some kind of alien hybrid, but the occasional tree looks almost natural. I'm sure with some tweaking you can find some specific value ranges that will create different types of trees. As usual, there are no hard and fast rules with this type of thing. Experiment and try different things and see what you can create. For the next type of fractal tree, we'll be turning to the Pythagorean theorem as we discussed in an earlier episode. You might be wondering what the Pythagorean theorem has to do with trees. So let's refresh what that is visually. If you have a right triangle with sides A, B, and C, you know that A squared plus B squared equals C squared. We can see this visually by drawing the squares themselves. A squared here, then b squared, then c squared. The area of those two smaller squares added together is equal to the area of this larger square. See the tree? No? Let me rotate this whole thing around. How about now? The big square is the trunk, and the two smaller squares are the branches. We can then take each smaller square and turn it into a Pythagorean tree like this, and this. And then do the same thing for each of those smaller squares. Please forgive my lack of freehand drawing ability, those are supposed to be squares. Now there are all kinds of ways to code this, so we better come up with a strategy before we start. I'm going to use canvas transformations because it will save us a ton of complicated trigonometry. I've done this a bunch of times and I still haven't found a drop-dead simple way of doing this. If someone finds a simpler way, please share. But I think what I'm going to show should be understandable enough. Our tree function is going to take an xy point, a size, and an angle, and of course a limit like all the others we've done. For our first iteration, the xy point will be down here. The angle will be 0, and the size will be, say, 100. We'll translate the context origin to the xy point, rotate it by the angle, 0 here, and then draw a square at 0, 0, using size for the width and minus size for the height, so that it extends upward like this. Now we need to draw the two smaller branch squares. We won't explicitly be drawing this triangle, but it will be created by drawing the squares, and we'll be right in here. So we need to iterate this so that the next two squares are drawn like this. we can translate up on the y-axis by 100 to get the point for this square. We'll rotate this by this angle. And we'll have to use some trig to figure out the size. Fairly simple. For the second square, we'll have to use some trig to find this point and its size. The angle will be the first angle plus 90 degrees. If limit is 0, we can just translate, rotate, and draw squares there. If limit is greater than 0, we call the tree function with the values we just calculated and limit minus 1. Lots of code details to work out still, but that's our strategy. So first we need to know the angles that make up that right triangle. Actually, the way it works out, we'll only wind up needing one of those angles. So I'll make a variable called branch angle A and set it to minus 45 degrees or minus math pi divided by 4 radians. Minus because from the way we're viewing it, it's going to rotate counterclockwise. Then we'll create the tree function. It gets x, y, size, angle, and limit. First we'll save the context, translate to x, y, rotate to angle, and draw a square using size minus size. And we'll restore the context just before we exit the function. Then we need to calculate the x, y, size, and angle for the left-hand square. X will be 0. Remember that we translated to the x, y that was just passed in, so the origin is at the bottom left of the trunk square. And y will be minus size. Again, just moving up that distance on the y-axis. Draw this out if you need to. We can calculate the new size using some trig. It will be math cosine branch angle A times size. Again, draw this all out, and it should be pretty clear if you're up on your trig. If not, this video is on all that stuff earlier. I'm also going to use math.abs to get the absolute value of that size, just to make sure it's positive. The new angle will simply be branch angle A. Now, if limit is greater than 0, we'll just call tree with these new parameters and limit minus 1. If limit reaches 0, we'll just draw a square there. I'll reuse this drawing code from the trunk square, changing the values to the ones we just calculated. Don't forget to restore the context here. Then we'll move on to the next square. This one is a bit more complex, so let's look at it visually. The origin is down here, and we need this point here. We can do this with math or do it with transformations. Let's use some math just so we don't get all lazy using so many transformations. We know that this point is 0 minus size. And we know that this is angle A. And we've just calculated this size here. So this point will be an x of 0 plus cosine angle A times size 0. And a y of minus size plus sine of angle A times size 0. Since this angle is 90 degrees, the angle we want to pass to this square is angle A plus 90. That 90, of course, will be converted to radians. And the size will be math sine angle A times the original size. I hope that's somewhat clear. Once again, get out some paper and a pencil and draw this out and work out the relationships until it's clear in your head, if it's not already. Okay, back in the code. We get the new x and y as x1 equals x0 plus math cosine angle 0 times size 0, and y1 equals y0 plus math sine angle 0 times size 0. Then the new size. Size 1 is math abs, math sine, branch angle A, times size. And angle 1. Angle 1 equals angle 0 plus math pi divided by 2. Everything else is the same. I'll just copy and paste this in here and change the zeros to ones. Finally, we call the tree function with an x of width divided by 2, minus 75, a y of height, a size of 150, rotation of 0, and limit of 0. That should give us a decently sized tree. And there's a pi tree with a limit of 0. And 1, 2, we'll jump up to 6, and then up to 12. Beautiful, isn't it? Now let's randomize the angles. I'll use random range to set angle A to between 0 and minus math pi divided by 2. Now we get all kinds of Pythagorean trees, from tall beanstalks to really strange-looking things. There's a sweet spot in here, too, where it just curls all together just right. You can randomize the tree angles as it's building as well, but that's a bit more complex here, as the two branch angles always have to add up to 90 degrees. And if you start messing with them on one branch, they'll break the branches that have yet to be drawn. It can be done, but you have to work out some way to preserve the angles for later. You'll see what I mean if you try it out. Another thing you might want to try is animating the trees. Here's an animated simple tree, and an animated Pythagorean tree. I'll put the code for these in the GitHub repo, but try it out yourself first. Have fun with these, and see you next time.